Hi, this is Ernie Ramirez for the Business of Hollywood. We're here with William A. Schaeffer, background actor, animation, paint artist. You tell me. The technology of television, film, anything that you kind of foresee would be tomorrow's toys.
I think the internet, but everything is a double-edged sword, and we've been through a very fortunate period. I think we have some global issues that will demand attention, and I think global climate change is going to be a big one, and that would be very troubling. So we could be in a very difficult transition period, but certain achievements that we've made, like electricity, the internet, the telecommunications, are here to stay. And that's what's exciting, that ordinary people can take high quality images and sound and preserve them and manipulate them themselves. And they communicate those images and sound to other people around the world. And that, the exponential combinations of possibilities of what that could lead to is unimaginable. And you can go, kind of, if you can think of it, it could happen. If you can think of it, it could happen. So if you can conceive of it, I mean, just because you've conceived of it, it's conceivable. Yeah. It could happen.
So mind will play an important role on the investment, I should say, the advancement of man using our
mind. Mind is everything.
Mind.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mind. So a lot of the people that we talked about today use their mind to identify the future at the early time of the 1900s.
Yeah.
But as you travel through the different decades, you come to this point to where your mind took part in a lot of the new technologies that were embedded back in the early 1900s.
That's what I feel lucky about. My life has been difficult in some ways, but what a ride. I got to witness the entire growth of the computer era.
Right.
It would be like if you were back in ancient Sumeria when they invented writing, and some guy goes, look, I can make these scribbles on this board, and then I can hand it to this guy, and he'll go over there, and he can say exactly what you said. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's kind of that, no one ever thought of that writing before, or counting in Babylon when they invented counting, or wherever they invented counting. And this has been an explosive transition for humanity. This is just the beginning. This is like zero AD. The beginning of the internet, and the positive potential for people is everyone has more of an opportunity to realize their full potential they're born with. In Europe in the Middle Ages, 90% of the population were slaves, serfs. Serf is the French word for slave. They had no freedom at all. They were uneducated. They couldn't leave the land. All they did was serve the needs of the overlord. Now, it's possible you can educate yourself, you can be free, and you can fulfill your birthright. Whatever, everyone is born with a birthright of what their potential of what they can do is.
And this is referred back into mind.
Yes. Oh, mind. And, you know, mind is everything. Now, it depends on how esoteric you want to get. Some people think the only reason the world exists is because we're there to see it. And on a small scale, we know that's true with subatomic quantum physics, that an electron does not have a position in the atom until someone looks at the electron. But until it's and it's not that we don't know it because we're not looking at it, it's that it does not exist until the human interacts with that electron. And in a bigger way, that may be the whole world. There's a lot to mind and the power of the mind. It's very difficult to talk about without being all kind of hokey pokey and hocus pocus and losing your mind.
Mm-hmm.
But mind is everything, and if you can think it,
well,
it can happen.
Then that's so true.
And that's why we have art.
Yeah.
That is why we have art.
And that's why, see, when you look at it, when you look at all this, okay, when you look at all this, I looked at this and I said to me, he's a traveler, he's a world traveler. You can tell so many different stories within the depiction and product, I call it product placement,
of
decades of work, you see. And that's why I asked you, I go, it seems like you've been around the world quite a few times, and now as I see this, you know, it's true.
Well, so,
but it came from mine, it came from somewhere to where that information has been stored in there for decades. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
So you can see, again, I was to give numbers of what decades he's come from the early 1900s all the way to present time. Look at it. But one thing about this, it belonged to somebody someday. I mean, it belonged to somebody at one time, and you picked it up.
Right.
Now,
right.
You put it on the wall, telling their story, going back to when they first originated, picked it up.
Well, the two of hearts is like that. This old weathered, old beat-up car that's been around forever. It's way over there, and we can get a close-up to insert. But here's what I want to say. You touched on a very, very important thing that we just, that's even bigger than that whole thing you're talking about. This is why art exists. Art is a cultural feedback loop. The great changes, developments, transition in human society and human thought occurred first in the arts when people didn't even know what it was, and it was later incorporated into life. And here's a great example, is perspective painting. Now, perspective painting the Greeks knew about perspective painting, and that's a science, that's geometry. It was lost during the Middle Ages, and during the Renaissance, they rediscovered perspective painting and the science of perspective in the camera obscura. And they used the camera obscura probably for about 100 years, making these photorealistic paintings that no one knew how they did it. But the whole practice of perspective and geometry preceded Newton and the laws of mechanics. And you could not bite a couple hundred years. And so for a few hundred years, engineers or budding engineers and mathematicians were sitting in churches and looking at illustrations that were done with geometric perspective. And then it was the geometry came first in the artist, then it was used in the engineering. The same thing with relativity. In the 1800s, Van Gogh and the other artists, impressionist artists, introduced the idea of the art being relative to their position. You know, prior to the impressionists, the art was like a big movie. It was like a mythical illustration of a mythical story. And it was from this God's eye perspective. But the impressionists were the one that took the art to me interacting with the world, and this is my painting in me. And they preceded special and general relativity by 50 years. And the world, the universe is relativistic. The appearance of the world that Einstein told us in relativity depends on our perspective and our vision of it. But the idea came first in the arts. And the same thing with music, was democratic before, you know, to mirror the democracy of the society. And the great ideas that transform and change society come unwittingly in the arts. First, the Greek mythology, which led to drama, which led to psychology. And that's why we have art, because the universe is so big and our brains are so tiny and our lives are so short that we'll never really understand it or make sense of it. But we can learn to grasp more and more of it over time.
Now, you have a lot of pieces that are picked up in the early, or I should say, of the 50s. I've noticed a lot of the toys or artifacts are based on that period of time, only certain ones that were used like the little dolls and stuff. I could be wrong, but the late 60s?
That's just intuitive. I'm not really a collector. And they're just little things that I see. And I try and really stay intuitive, like not, I'm not a cataloger. I don't make catalogs of things. And most of these were bought, a lot of these were bought at the store, a lot of those things too, and some were found underground. And all the silverware is weird. The spoons are too long and knives and forks are too short. I bought them because they were weird. Some garage sale or some flea market.
But I noticed that you duplicated almost the same spoon. Each one has the same style.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The fans are the same style. And it's kind of repetitious, but I noticed that some of the cards there are different, telling a story for each of the...
Well, it was consciously done. I made the one in the center first. Okay. And that was consciously arranged. And then I had some of the elements left over, and I thought it'd be fun to make a second one. I actually made two more at the same time. And it was an exercise in, like, you always have a lizard right there, you always have a fan, the cards are in the same place, so the top one is the man, the bottom one is the woman, and then this is the emotion, right, kind of like the heart, the vessel, and the scorpion. There's always fortunes, there's always two aliens, two pirates, one Hawaiian girl, you know, so there's always a little monkey, the watcher here, there's always a roach hiding behind the fan. That's it. You know, there's always that penalty. And I like roaches a lot. I don't like them in real life at all. But I mean, the little plastic ones as an art element because they're repulsive. Yeah. And I think it's funny to have flashers in art because you look at something that hurts your eyes and you're supposed to look at it and it's supposed to hurt your eyes and it's just wrong. But it's funny at the same time.
And how many people have visited here?
This, it's hard to say, maybe 30 to 50, this show. There were maybe 30.
So you have more shows in the world?
I don't have any planned. I'd love to do some more. This was a phenomenal amount of work for me.
Right.
Really, this was a breakthrough for me. Both that I had the time to do it, that I did it. It took me 3 full days, 12 to 16 hours.
And how many years have you been?
This is about 15 years of work.
15 years of work.
15 years.
Combined. In a room. A couple of days of work.
And taken out of storage, and mostly out of storage, and fixed and put up back in the walls. And I could do a whole other room this size of almost this quality, not quite this quality.
So are you taking your showing out on the road someday?
I don't know. I would like, I'd hope to sell it more. What I'd really like to do is find people that want to take pieces into their home and then worry about preserving them on their own. Mm-hmm. And then I can send them out into the world. Because it's, you know, it's fun to make things. It's really fun to make them, and it's no fun to store them.
Yeah.
And it's no fun to sell them, but you have to get rid of them. Because you have to give them to someone else. So that's really what I hope is. If you see a piece you like, contact me and you can get it cheap.
Will this some of your work be put on the internet?
It already is.
Whatever it is.
Yeah, I should announce my YouTube channel, which you may be watching right now, is atwaterpub, youtube.com/user/atwaterpub, atwaterpub. In my blog, it's very simple, atwaterpub.blogspot.com. Mm-hmm. And on the blog, I have the program from the show with photos of all the paintings inserted so you can see what they're talking about.
Well, that's great work. Really, I think I'm looking at this as the 50s here, all these toys and figurines. That period pieces, which have, again, all three of them all tell the same story, but they all have different characteristics of people that you customize for their...
Well, that's what I like about repetition. Edward Monk, who painted the screen, there's 3 or 4 screen paintings.
Right.
And Magritte painted the same painting 2 or 3 times for a couple of paintings.
Right.
And that's kind of, and gave it the same name. Painted the same painting, gave it the same name. Same as Monk did with the screen. And that's kind of an interesting idea that I did here. Paint the same thing. This is the Magic Lantern Theater also, from Steppenwolf by Hermann Hesse. And in the story, Steppenwolf, the character Henry Haller goes to the Magic Lantern Theater, where he sees the story of his own life portrayed for him as entertainment. And he gets a pamphlet, The Steppenwolf, that describes his life. And then he can never find the Magic Lantern Theater ever again. Mm-hmm. And that was kind of the inspiration for this, the Magic Lantern Theater. In a way, the magical story of my life at the time I had. Because your dreams, your images are in the theater of your mind. It's black with a little spotlight.
Theater of your mind.
Yeah. Well, we all have a theater in our mind where we see something, we think of something,
right,
and we call it up into the spotlight and we look at it.
Which you call manifest.
Yeah.
Manifest from mind to vision and to presentation.
And that's why we have art. To help us understand what we're seeing as painters,
right,
learn to see by the process of painting,
right,
and drawing is an education in what is really there, drawing from life, and they do that here, they have good life drawing courses here, and then by looking at art, we understand our place in the universe,
right,
and by making it, we understand who we are.
Along those lines, do you think that this exhibit will kind of educate maybe a younger generation of kids that are looking at maybe stories like what you've unfolded to us?
Maybe. I don't know. My intention for this really was more to just have fun.
Mm-hmm.
Just fun. I wanted when people walked in, when they saw it, that they would have a kind of a lightness. Oh, that's fun. And now, humor is ours in education. Because we humor is where we have two different ideas that are mutually exclusive. They self-contradict each other, and they can exist at the same time, but they do. And then the only way we can handle that without going in an infinite recursive loop of craziness is we laugh.
Right.
And the laughter releases the contradiction, and we go, oh, those things are both true at the same time, and they can't be, but they are. Isn't that fun? And that's the basis of all humor, all jokes, whether it's physical humor, written jokes, and then that's what I wanted. So in that way, humor is always educating people. That's why we love comedians.
Well,
that's why we love the great comedians.
And I say young kids of tomorrow.
If young kids like this art, then I would be really happy. If anyone likes it, I'm happy. And when children like enjoy listening to me play piano, that makes me feel much better than when their parents enjoy it.
Right.
Because kids are innocent. They tell you what they think. And if they like it, then you've managed to communicate and touch.
We're here at the Animation Guild in Burbank, California. You opened your showing last Friday.
Last Friday.
You had a number of 30 people, you said 30 people. Give me kind of the demographics of what type of people came to see this. Because this is kind of like an entertainment city here in Burbank.
Right. Well, the gallery is a little bit off the beaten path of the whole gallery system. But mostly, there were three groups of people. I've worked as a digital rotoscope artist, and I've worked as a background actor.
Mm-hmm.
And there were groups, you know, friends from both of those groups that I'm in the game, and then people also that were associated with the Animation Guild 839 that heard about it in the publication, and they were, and there was pretty much everyone there. Most of the people I knew, and it was nice to see everyone was talking and having fun.
Okay, here we have it, William A. Schaeffer in Burbank, California, for the Business of Hollywood. Thank you for joining us this afternoon and giving us your time on your showing here at the Animation Guild in Burbank, California.
Very good, thank you.
Good?
Yeah.
And I did it off the cuff, I didn't have it scripted.
Yeah, that's